Portainer here, and in this video, I'm going to talk about Kubernetes RBAC. It can be quite challenging. Managing RBAC with Kubernetes comes with a certain amount of complexity and a good amount of manual effort. And I'm going to show here two different strategies that we can use to manage RBAC in Kubernetes. One is using the manual strategy of writing YAML files or YAML definitions, and the second one is with Portainer. And you'll see how much easier it is to use Portainer and how much more it makes sense to use Portainer than the traditional YAML definitions or YAML files. So let's start by understanding a little bit of the user role concepts in Kubernetes. I want to start with the RBAC roles. There's at least four roles that are quite well known. The cluster admin, he's like a super user. He can do anything in the cluster in terms of the management of a Kubernetes environment. The admin role, he has unlimited read-write access to resources within a namespace. The edit role grants read-write access within a given Kubernetes namespace. It cannot view or modify roles or role bindings. And finally, the view, which is like a view access, a read-only access control of given namespaces. So these are just some of the well-known roles within Kubernetes. The other thing I want to mention is, well, what does this mean in terms of practical challenges of Kubernetes in terms of RBAC? First of all, Kubernetes comes with an RBAC engine, but it doesn't have a tool to manage RBAC whatsoever. That means that pretty much everything has to be done manually. And if you need to, for instance, update a role of a given user, you have to revoke that role and replace it with a new one. And if this user has, like, for instance, more than one role in a given cluster for different namespaces or resources, you can very easily make mistakes because you have to do that per resource in your cluster that you want to manage via RBAC. There is no visibility in terms of user access, so there isn't any way of easily identifying which level the user has within a cluster. Finally, visibility into cluster configurations. So Kubernetes also lacks functionality to help you manage complex RBAC configurations. That means that you're totally on your own when it comes to keeping track of roles binding, cluster roles bindings, service accounts, tokens, storage, and secrets. Well, pretty much everything that you've configured within your RBAC in Kubernetes. To put this in a simple way, Kubernetes RBAC does not provide much help when it comes to managing or monitoring your configuration data. Right, let me start with the first strategy, which is using the manual way of setting up user roles. So here I have in my environment a micro K8s node. And it only has RBAC enabled here. So let's start by creating a read-only access for a user type. I will pipe this. So let me clear the screen here. And I am going to pipe this into the Kubernetes cluster using the K8s UI piping. And this is the role definition. It's read-only. The namespace is default. So any user that is assigned to this role will have a role binding of this role will only have read-only access to the default namespace. If I hadn't defined the name of the namespace, this would automatically be assigned it to the default namespace anyway. Okay, so let me close this piping. And I have a read-only access definition created. Okay, so let me assign this to a user. Okay, same thing. I'm going to pipe it with kubectl. Zef, y. As you can see, it's a role binding, read-only role binding, the name of the user. Okay, and oops, I have an error. This is how things start to get challenging when using YAML definitions, right? Okay, so maybe it's because I'm using spaces and comments. Let me try it with a with the same, let's say, in a sanitized manner without these comments. Let's try this again. Kubectl create sf minus EOY. As you can see, this is like sanitized. I removed all the comments and spaces, and now it worked. So here's an example of creating a read-only access and doing a role binding to this definition to a given user. In this case, user name John. Right. So far, apart from the initial error, everything seems to be fine. Now let's say I want to create a read-write access to a namespace called dev. So the first thing I have to do is to have to make sure that the namespace dev exists. So kubectl get pod all namespaces. So I'm just bringing all the namespaces and all the pods, and I only have kube system. So I have to create this namespace. Kubectl create namespace dev. Okay. I'm doing this because I know that if I don't have this namespace defined, I cannot create a role to this given namespace. Kubectl create minus f minus e or y. And you can see that the resources that I have here are slightly different. The previous one was only get, list, and watch. Now I have get, list, watch, create, update, patch, and delete. And it's been successfully created. And I want to add this to a user called Peter. As you can see, this is pretty much the process of creating roles and role bindings with a specific strategy of role types with Kubernetes. So here, what I'm doing is I'm doing a read-write binding to user Peter. Nice. I think that as things progress, you will understand how complex this becomes. Now I want to create a cluster role binding for a super user. And it's similar to creating a role binding to the namespaces. But in this case, it's going to be to the cluster. Kubectl create xf minus y. And as you can see, it's a cluster role. So now the name is super user, and these are the rules. Very similar to the previous ones. Get, list, watch, create, update, patch, and delete. Ooh, again, an error. This is when, again, things start to get tricky. What did I do wrong? I'm going to try to fix this one more time, see if I can manage, and see if it works. Kubectl create xf minus y. I think everything should be fine here. And it worked. And if you look at it, I cannot see the difference between this one and this one. I swear that I cannot see the difference, but definitely there is one. Again, challenges of using YAML definitions. I want to finally finish this by assigning this to a user. Kubectl create xf y. Hope it works, because now I don't know. It worked. You have three users, Joe, John, and Peter. Each one has a role in this environment. One is a super user, one is a developer that has read-write access to a given namespace called dev, and the other one has read-only access to the default namespace. If I want to mix and match things, I have to keep creating these YAML definitions over and over again for each user, for each row, and if I want to create new roles, I have to do this over and over again and keep creating this. And as you can see, I just did the piping. I have no files written here whatsoever. And I have to make sure I'm storing this somewhere, which in this case I did already. GitHub, actually. I went here and I stored these here. So imagine that you have more users in your team. Next thing you know, you have a team of 10 developers. And you have to make sure that you know which role each member of your team is going to have in which part of your Kubernetes cluster, be that as a cluster role binding or just as a role binding to a given namespace or resource. And this is going to start growing and growing and growing and growing. And every time your team changes, because your team might be project oriented, you have to redefine these files over and over again. So this is hard work. Just by having them stored in a Git server, in this case GitHub, doesn't mean that you have enough control over what is going on in your environment. So somehow you have to have a control of what is being assigned to who, because again, Kubernetes will not do that for you. There's no way to do this easily with Kubernetes. And then you can, you know, use an Excel spreadsheet or text file, I don't know, whatever you believe is the most appropriate. But then if you're talking about sensitive information that you don't want to, you know, have easily available, you might need to encrypt this file, or you might have to use a database. So basically what I'm trying to show here is that this is not at all simple. So now I'm going to do a comparison with Portainer. So now I'm going to deploy Portainer Business Edition on this node to start showing you how easy it is to use the RBAC functionalities of Portainer with Kubernetes. Okay, so now let me open my browser. I'm going to define an admin user. I'll just put Adolfo. Define a password. Create this user. Okay, and now I need to add a license. And now I can configure my Kubernetes environment here. I'm going to, for now, just enable the local storage. Save the configuration, and now I have access to this Kubernetes cluster. Let's check the namespaces. It has two namespaces defined, dev and db. I had created db previously. Let me see if I have users here. I only have user Adolfo as the administrator. Let's start by adding users. User Joe. I'm not going to add him as an administrator, just as a standard user. John. Mary. And Jay. Okay. So now I have four users defined, and I want to define a team of developers. Those would be, and I'm going to call this team dev. I'm now going to associate users to this team. I'm going to create the team. The team is created. I'm going to access the team, and the team members are Jane and John. This is how easy it is to define teams with Portainer. It's just, you know, no coding, no YAML definitions, nothing. So now I want to make sure that this team has access to the Kubernetes endpoint. I could have more than one endpoint, and each endpoint could be a representation of a Kubernetes cluster that could be running locally on the same machine, on my network, in a cloud provider, and I could use the same set of users throughout all the endpoints being managed by this Portainer instance. I don't need to recreate the users for each endpoint. I have one single set of users that I define here and manage them across any number of endpoints defined in this Portainer instance. So let's say I want to give the dev team access to this endpoint as standard users. What this means is that anyone within the dev group is going to have standard user access to this endpoint. Now, the namespace dev, I want to provide access to the dev team. And as you can see, I only see the dev team as an option because only this dev team has been associated to that Kubernetes endpoint. So as you can see, it's very easy to manage access to resources, and you know, be that as teams, be that as individual users. And I'm going to show an example now of individual users that could have access to different resources within this Kubernetes cluster. Now I have Joe and Mary. Joe and Mary haven't been associated to any resources within this cluster. And when I say resources, it could be endpoints, it could be registries, or namespaces. So let's say I want to associate to the namespace DB, John and Mary. I won't be able to because John and Mary haven't been associated to any endpoints. So I have to go back to my Kubernetes endpoint and also add John and, sorry, that's Joe and Mary. Is that correct? Is it Joe and Mary? Now I don't remember. But hey, how hard is it to check? Just go to users, teams, dev, and yep, John and Jay. So really, Joe and Mary are not part of that team. What does this mean? That it's also very easy to manage users within teams in with Portainer, which is something that is not at all easy with Kubernetes. Now I have associated Joe and Mary also to the Kubernetes endpoint. So the dev team, Joe and Mary have access to the Kubernetes endpoint. So now on the namespace DB, I want to grant access to Joe and Mary. Oh, but they're not here. Why is that? Because when I granted access to Joe and Mary to this Kubernetes endpoint, I granted access as endpoint administrators, meaning that if Joe and Mary log into their Portainer instance, they will automatically see everything within this Kubernetes environment. And it's not what I want. So now I want to update their profiles to go and say that they are both standard users. And I'm going to update their profiles. Again, as you can see, updating the roles of a user with Portainer is also very easy. I don't need to revoke the previous role to be able to grant a new one, and I don't have to write any YAML definitions or files. It's just a matter of, by the UI, update the user's role. Now I can go to this namespace DB and grant access to Joe and Mary. Now they have user access to this namespace. Finally, I wanted to show the roles defined within Portainer. So here, when you go to users roles, you see each of the five predefined user roles that are similar to the ones that I described initially in this video. So for instance, if I go to user John here on my roles viewer, I can see what endpoint user John is associated to and which role he has in this endpoint, which is also a very interesting feature because, as we know, Kubernetes lacks this type of visibility. And here we can very easily see how this is done with Portainer. In my opinion, very clear how much easier it is to use RBAC with Portainer versus using RBAC with the traditional Kubernetes deployment, which would be the manual definition of YAML into your Kubernetes cluster. I hope you enjoyed this video. Thank you very much.